after that, we're gonna stay in North Carolina here. We're gonna go to Dr. Beth Darrow, who's gonna talk about some of the ecosystem services of shellfish aquaculture and some of the work she's done in North Carolina. Thank you.
And I observed it, and it is the amount of oysters that they have handled. It's a huge effort, so good job, Chuck and company. I want to talk a little bit about a different study. I'm also from UNC Wilmington. But I'm working with some collaborators who include growers with your customers, talk that up with the public, because it's something that managers especially get excited about. I know as a scientist I get excited about it, so I want to dive in a little bit to what are ecosystem services and how are we measuring them. So we have a three-year study. It's through the NEAR Science Collaborative Program, which is a NOAA program. And through this program, they really encourage us to work with what they call stakeholders. So stakeholders are anybody who has a vested interest in this question, scientific question. Our stakeholders are divided up into what we call end users. These are people who are making decisions, potentially based on the findings of our study. And then there are other stakeholders who are just basically people who care. So here's a list of my collaborators, scientists, managers, end users, growers, and other people who might just be interested or who might have a vested interest in this area. So when I talk about ecosystem services, there's a long history in our country and throughout the world of people recognizing that shellfish have a lot of uses besides just consumption. They all love to eat oysters, but even Native Americans knew that they could provide structures. They use them to help strengthen their pottery. They use them for tools. And then once agriculture began, people started using the shells as soil conditioner, and a lot of roads were built from oysters. In fact, I think they said that New York City was built on the back of the oyster. So we have a long history of using these animals for lots of purposes besides just consumption. When we think about a wild oyster reef, scientists have been studying these ecosystem services for a while now, about 30 years or so. We've been looking at things like filtration and habitat that oyster reefs provide. We're not quite there yet with measuring these things for aquaculture, so that's what we're trying to do. So just to step through a few of the things that that have been quantified. So when we talk about filtration, you may have heard that oyster reefs remove nitrogen from the water column. When we say that, what they're actually doing is they're removing that phytoplankton. Right? They're removing the particulate matter in the water column, which has a lot of nitrogen in it. So they're not actually just removing like dissolved fertilizer from the water column, they're removing that particulate matter. In doing so, they're moving that nitrogen into their biomass, that's what causes growth, and they're also moving some of it to the sediment through their feces and pseudofeces. In doing so, they're clarifying the water, which will then allow more light penetration to the bottom. So in areas where you have seagrass, that can be a real benefit. The oyster reefs are creating a hard bottom substrate, which could be a substrate for other animals, commercially formed organisms, all types of other, found organisms. And by building these reefs, they stabilize the sediment. So we're interested in looking at if oyster aquaculture can do the same things. And there have been a few studies looking at different parts, components of this. But we wanted to add to the growing number of studies doing this, especially in North Carolina, where the oyster aquaculture industry is just getting started, especially with the containerized systems. So we're looking at the filtration capacity of oyster farms. We're looking at that nitrogen removal capacity. We're looking at how that nitrogen gets moved into oyster biomass through harvest, and also how that nitrogen gets moved into the sediments. You may have heard of a process called denitrification, so that's another potential fate of nitrogen in these systems. It's something that is really hard to measure, and it's also really dependent on different chemical conditions, temperature, salinity, things like that. A few people have measured denitrification successfully in oyster farms, like up in Chesapeake Bay. But we're not really able to put good numbers on that yet, so I'm not doing that as part of this study. Keep in mind that that is something that people consider as well, but it doesn't always happen all the time, as far as we know yet, in all oyster. And just to step back, denitrification is where you're removing nitrogen from the system by that nitrogen being turned into gas. So that goes back to the atmosphere. So it's a microbial process that can be kind of complex. So we're also going to be looking at the habitat quality of oyster cages. So we know we put cages out there, it's a substrate. Those Fallon communities we're talking about, that's actually, that's sort of a benefit. All those things are filtering too. Also, we know that fish and things are attracted to oyster cages. I'm sure you've seen them. Things like birds, whether you like them or not, they're there. So we want to try to put numbers on these things because managers do care about these services. And if they're trying to decide about siting, they might want to be able to weigh the pros and cons of these different things and do so using numbers. Here's an example of how some of these things have been used in the past. On the left is the NOAA National Eutrophication Assessment. So this is a large nationwide study that was done looking at water quality in a lot of different estuaries throughout the country. NOAA cares a lot about water quality. They'll do things like they'll give a report card grade or color going from blue is better and red is bad, kind of like stop sign type things. So you can see all the different areas that they assessed, and red are kind of bad areas for water quality. So these are areas where they're interested in improving water quality, and one of the measures that they're looking at to improve water quality is oyster aquaculture. So in Maryland, for example, they're starting to use oyster aquaculture as they call it best management practice to remove nitrogen from estuaries that's already there. So how do they measure this? Two of my collaborators developed what's called the FARM model, and that's the diagram on the right. And the idea is it's a pretty simple model as far as models go, mathematical models go. The idea is you just have water moving into a farm that carries food with it. There's a filtration rate that's associated with the number of oysters on that farm and their size, and then the water goes out the other side, and you can calculate how much nitrogen is removed from the farm. So you can combine this with different scenarios, with different grow-out densities, different stocking densities, different characteristics of the different sites, so the amount of food coming in, the flow rates, things like that, and then come out with sort of this checkbook approach where at the end you have a mass balance of the amount of nitrogen that gets removed. And the cool thing about having a pounds of nitrogen number is that you can convert that to nitrogen removal from, say, wastewater treatment plant and say, what's the value of this? We can compare them, apples and apples, which is pretty cool. So they've done this in Europe, they've done it in Long Island Sound, and we're going to start doing it in North Carolina. The other benefit to this model is it gives information to the farmers. So you can try different densities of oysters and say, do I have enough food here to support these oysters? How long is it going to take me to get to market size? What's the harvest value going to be if I try different stocking densities? Things like that. Okay, so just zooming in now to North Carolina. In 2015, there were two farms that were approved to go in the National Estuarine Research Reserve. And if you want to talk more about reserves and what that means, I'd be happy to chat over beer with that about that. But this is one of the few areas in southeast North Carolina outside of Wilmington where there's really clean, pristine water. We're not, even though we're just across the Intercoastal Waterway from Wilmington, water quality is really good. And there are no homes right there overlooking it, so there are people, complaining about not in my backyard, supposedly. So it might be a really good place for aquaculture. It's managed by federal and state entities, which makes it a little complicated. But we're interested in looking specifically here because it had had an aquaculture before, so we could really observe changes through time, if there were any. And in bringing in our stakeholders to the whole process, we really hoped to minimize conflict, that we could all sort of agree on what the important parameters were to measure, and that we could increase communication, collaboration from the group by recognizing that these groups have a lot of similar goals. And the main one, in my mind, is stewardship. The managers want to be good stewards of the resources. There are some of the managers whose main job it is to protect the resources. But growers also want to protect natural resources. You wouldn't be in this line of work if you didn't love being out there in nature. And you also recognize that you're not going to have a good product if you're not protecting water quality. So these are the two farms where we're working right now on Mesaboro Island. We have what we call Farm 1, which is floating gear that floats most of the time, depending on the tide. Sometimes it sits on the bottom. And then Farm 2, it's bottom gear, and it's a little shallower site. So two similar sites, they're pretty close to each other in one embankment, but they do get different amounts of flow and different water quality, we found. Okay, so how are we measuring this? So it's taking water samples across these farms monthly. We're also taking quarterly sediment samples across and doing transects across the farms to see how the farm different characteristics are changing. I'm going to focus just on nitrogen today, but we're measuring chlorophyll, carbon, sulfides, other things as well. The growers are also working with us and giving us their harvest information, which is really important for the model. And they're also allowing us to access their farms to measure the density of their bags and the number of oysters in their bags and the size of the oysters, which has been really great. I have a graduate student who is measuring in the lab those farmed oyster rates of feeding and restoration, which is all going to drive that model. So everything's going to be very specific to these farms, but we don't have the model out yet, so stay tuned in next year. I'll show you a little bit of data. So this just shows, I do hear from growers, they want to know how much chlorophyll is on their farms. So this is definitely the word chlorophyll is gotten out there, that this represents food. This is phytoplankton biomass. These are the plant pigments found in the chlorophyll. But I always stress that it's important to consider that the amount of food available to your oysters is not just the concentration of food, it's also the flow. So those things get multiplied together to provide that food to the oyster farm. So we have different food concentrations here, but we've also measured flow rates. So these things are going to be multiplied together when they go into the model. But you can see on the left that chlorophyll concentrations throughout the year, we have almost a year's worth of data here, were higher at Farm 1 than at Farm 2. There's a higher peak there, but they have pretty much a similar seasonal trend that you would expect to see. So we'll see, once we put this into the model, if that results in different oyster growth from different food concentrations. Okay, so is the chlorophyll being consumed as it crosses the farm? This is one of the concerns that managers had, is when you put a lot more bivalves in there and they're filtering all the time, are they going to remove food from our wild oysters? And I have one slide here that shows potential depletion of chlorophyll across the farm, but I'm telling you that this is the only month that this happened. So this is what it would look like if you did see maybe enough food being removed from a farm to actually make a difference. So as you go across the bottom, the x-axis, we're moving across the farm from upstream to downstream and in the direction of water flow, and then each of those points is a water sample that we took. Farm 2 is in the orangey-yellow, and then there's a control mud flat in the green. And the red outline is the farm footprint. So you can see that within the farm, you start to see a reduction in the chlorophyll concentration. You see that line going down, where you don't see it in the mud fly. So that's interesting, but I will say that that is the only time that happens. Sometimes it did the opposite. So, you know, you don't always see that change because that water is moving through really fast. It's a really dynamic system. The water's, you know, rushing past those oysters. They're feeding as fast as they can, but it's not always enough to actually be able to see a difference in that food concentration as it goes past. And that's where the model's gonna be really helpful, because we know that they're still eating because they're still growing. And in fact, it is a little back of the envelope calculation that with a harvest of 45,000 oysters, just the meat weight would be about 5 kilograms of nitrogen. So that's not even including the shells. So that amount of nitrogen at least is being removed from the water. Okay, so what about the sediments? So in order to start the process of denitrification, you actually have to have the nitrogen moving from the water column into the sediments through the oysters feeding on it and then pooping. So we wanted to see if we could see see that in the sediments under these farms or not. And our first results are showing that we are. We're able to see an increase in particulate nitrogen in the sediments under the farm. So it's a similar schematic where we're, in this case, the opposite because we sampled on the opposite tide, but they're the same stations. So that red box is showing the farm footprint. So there's an elevation of particulate nitrogen under the farm. And then what happens once that particulate nitrogen goes into the sediments? It starts being broken down by microbes. It turns into ammonium, which is the fuel for denitrification. So we do see an increase in dissolved nitrogen under the farms too. And we're seeing that in June, we saw it in December, and there's more nitrogen there than compared to the mud flat. So, you know, that could be maybe some people might think that's a cause of concern that we're seeing all this like poop and pee in the sediments, that's really bad. But it's actually, they're not really super high concentrations, and we're looking at other things like hydrogen sulfide and oxygen too. We know that those levels have been too high. So even though there is an elevation of nitrogen, it's sort of to be expected. And hopefully, you know, maybe in a couple years we'll be able to measure denitrification too and see if that's being removed from the system entirely. So our oysters are doing what they're supposed to do, they're processing the nitrogen. Okay, so what about habitat? We have a couple studies going on. Madison Lytle up there on the right next to Oyster House is doing for her thesis. She's looking at infaunal assemblages, and she's starting to see that there are increases in infauna, so these are the animals that live in the sediment, as you get closer to structures. So it doesn't really matter what kind of structure it is, she's finding. It could be a cage, it could be an oyster reef, it could be a restored oyster reef, animals like living near structure in the mud. And then this year we're starting a study looking at the actual cages. We're going to put like sampling nets around equivalent cages, areas of cage, wild oyster reef, mud flat, and then pop them up real quick and then catch everything in there and count on them. So we'll have some numbers next year on that. We're also using video and some other methods to try to get the mobile fauna to see what's happening with fish and blue crabs and things like that as well. So I think we all know intuitively that these farms are habitat, but it's really important to have numbers for this to be able to show managers and say, hey, I'm improving things here, you know, by providing habitat for all these different critters. So it would be good to have some numbers. We have a couple other undergraduate kind of side projects that got added on. So one is looking at zooplankton concentrations. And this is important because it's our larval oysters, it's our larval crabs, and it's also the copepods and things that are food for higher trophic levels. One interesting aspect that she found was a lot of microplastics in those samples. So I would love to chat with anyone if you know about plastics or if you're seeing plastics on your farm. Doesn't look so far like there are more plastics in the farms than in other places. We think that the plastics are just kind of everywhere all the time, which is kind of scary, but I think that's something that managers care about too, so something to keep in mind. Birds, I'd also love to chat with people about birds. I'm not really an ornithologist, but I can count birds. And we're finding that birds love to sit on cages, shocking. But again, this is something that there are no numbers in the scientific literature for. I found like one or two papers. So these are numbers that it would be really great to have because I know seasonally what's happening with the bird populations, especially in areas like reserves where they're important habitats for migratory populations. So in summary, you know, we're just getting started really. We're ending year one, collecting a ton of data, but hopefully we'll be able to provide farmers with information that will help them make decisions about their stocking densities and things like that. And that they'll also be able to go to managers and say, hey, this is a benefit that my farm is providing. So consider that because, you know, we're leasing public trust waters, right? So we want to be able to show that we're being good stewards and good neighbors. We're starting to see localized nitrogen inputs under some of these farms. So that's something to keep in mind too. Like consider when you're out there walking around, are you smelling a lot of like rotten egg sulfide smell? If so, maybe you're kind of contributing a little too much to the organic matter in your farm, so think about that. So next year, we'll have the data all inputted into the model. We're gonna kind of calibrate it, and we're gonna see how much nitrogen these farms are moving. So stay tuned.
Bethany, we're talking about, oh, thank you. That was for me. You were talking about the value of nitrogen removal and how your study is going to quantify that.
Yeah.
Has there any further discussion about what nitrogen credit possibilities would be as far as it turning actually into cash?
So that would be a
state level sort of management and legislative decision. But part of Jessica Kinsella's thesis is going to be actually making a comparison of the nitrogen that's removed compared to that whether it's a problematic area or not. So those eutrophication assessment scores, you want to be moving an estuary from, say, a red to an orange to a green. But if your estuary is already at green, then maybe you're not actually providing as much relative benefit. It's still a benefit, but maybe it's not as much relative benefit as, say, in Chesapeake Bay or someplace where they have a bad water quality. So it's a great question.
Yeah, the shells are carbonate in them. Are they removing CO2, maybe affecting acidity?
So that's a more complicated question. They do locally, but eventually those shells are gonna dissolve again. So that's something that people who study carbon are kind of struggling with trying to calculate that. But much like denitrification, it's not at the point yet where they can say, we have a good enough number here that we can provide standards and say, this is a real benefit. But because it carbon goes in and then the carbon comes out, it depends on your
question
state.
Was defined.
Define managers. In North Carolina, the people that we're talking to are our Division of Marine Fisheries because they deal with shellfish sighting, and then also our division or Department of Natural Resources who are involved with, because this is a reserve, they're involved with sort of that environmental protection component. So those are our managers, but it depends on site by site if you're talking to.
Government.
Yeah. The people, the decision makers.
So your reserve is a lot of commercial activity?
That's a great question. <We're thinking. laughs> So right now we are in a state of flux with that question. These farms were permitted in 2015 and they went through the whole public comment period and everything. But since then someone has found some fine print saying that because this site is actually a preserve, it's defined as a preserve. And again, with the National Estuary Research Reserve System, it's a state-by-state decision that's made by the state, actually, instead of the federal. So in North Carolina right now, it looks like they say that there's no commercial activity allowed within a preserve, but there's a lot of commercial activity going on in this preserve. There are crabbers, there's wild harvest, so someone's gonna have to define that a little better.
Be a little too progressive to think that you could create an oyster farming zone in a preserve.
I think that would be a great idea. Or like a research demonstration lease, or, you know, there are a lot of things that could be done.
U.S. Fish and Wild, you know, these are, when it comes to site selection, you can't get a cleaner site.
Exactly.
And you know, so, you know, it'd be a great landing.
Yes.
Thank you.